This video is a follow-on from the previous videos that looked at a digital clock. Here I'm going to add amendments to the computer program that will alter the runtime of the digital clock, introducing the ability to set the clock to be a larger and a smaller size. This is the digital clock that we've developed in the last few videos in this playlist, and you can see it simply is a clock that's counting up in seconds, and it is showing the minutes and also the hour of the day. Here is the digital clock again, but you can see here I've made an amendment. I have the word settings, which is going to be a drop down menu, but you can see the clock is counting up as normal. When I click on this, you can see there are two drop down items, small font size, which if I click on it, you can see that the clock goes smaller. If I go back to settings, you will see that the two drop down items appear again, and if I click on large font size, the clock goes back to where it normally is. This is the program we looked at in the previous video within the tkinter playlist. I'll quickly go over it here. These two lines you can see import the important modules for this program, namely the tkinter module and the time module, and you can see they have been imported to be known in the program by TK and TM respectively. This avoids naming conflicts within programs. The code I'm highlighting now is the definition of the digital clock class, and within it you can see we have three methods. We have the initialization method, we have a method called clock display that's going to be responsible for putting the label onto the window, and here we have the code that's going to be responsible for causing the clock to count up in seconds. This line creates an instance of a window. This line here creates an instance of the digital clock to which is sent the window, and this digital clock will then be known by this name in the code, and here you can see we enter the main loop for the program. Now when this program executes, you will see the clock that you viewed at the beginning of this video. I'm going to show you a screenshot of this clock here, but I'm not showing it counting up in seconds. It's just a snapshot of the clock. If I single step through this program, this will create the instance of the window, and then that instance name is passed here to the creation of the digital clock, which means it will arrive at this position, and it's now called the underscore window. And then I assign the underscore window to this name, which you can see is the underscore window, but it has the word self and the full stop in front of it, because the window we're now viewing with this name is the instance of the digital clock, and the use of the self is what identifies a specific instance of the digital clock. This line references the instance of the window, and it affects the title by setting it to the string digital clock, as you can see here. This line is responsible for calling this method here, and if we look at the call, we can see we have the word self full stop in front of this name, and that tells us we're dealing with the current instance that's created by the program here. If we look at this function, what we can see is that we've created a label that's called self.clock underscore label, and here you can see I've used the TK full stop that will avoid naming conflict, and I'm creating a label with reference to this window here, which means the label will appear on this window. Here you can see I'm setting the font to Arial size 80 and the background color of the label is black. Then you can go on and see that I've set the foreground color to red, and that is of course the color of the font that appears on the black label, and you can see the time is indeed in the color red. This is the line responsible for placing the label using the grid method at row 0, column 0, and consequently the label will appear here within the window. This method has now finished executing, so control will now be returned to this method, which will result in this executing, because this is the program statement that immediately came after this call, which was responsible for calling this method here. And of course, this is a call to this method, and this method is responsible for setting the label to the current time. This is the first line of the method to execute, and you can see here we're using this module, and from this module we are using this method, and we're passing in this, which is asking for the time to be returned in hours, minutes and seconds. And of course, what this will get is a value that it will pass to this here, current underscore time. And of course, we have to have the self in front of it so we can easily refer to the current instance that's created of the digital clock class. Now, this line will take the current time value just returned by the line above, and it will assign it to the text property of this label, and consequently, the label as shown here will display the current time. What this line will do is invoke this method and set a clock running for 200 milliseconds in the background. And then, of course, this method will finish its execution and will go back to here. And because this call was the last line of execution of this method, we will find ourselves returning to here. And this is the main loop. So the program is now going around in the main loop. Now, the Python program is currently going around this main loop. But you have to remember that on this line, you set a timer in the background. And this timer was set to run for 200 milliseconds. Now, when that 200 milliseconds has finished, we leave this main loop. And this tells us to execute this method. Consequently, we get the current time. We assign it to this variable. We then use that variable here and assign to the text property of the label the new current time. Of course, it's worth noting that I set this to 200 milliseconds, and I went into detail about why we would make this 200 milliseconds and not 1 second in a previous video. But just very, very quickly, you make it 200 milliseconds here, and of course, it's likely that this will call 5 calls to this function before this here changes, because that's how long it would take for 1 second to pass. But you make this smaller because you can get time drift, because you have to take into account that all of these program statements take a certain amount of time to execute. I've taken the program we've looked at on the previous slide and I've made additions to it. One of the additions I wish to refer you to is here. You can see that I have a call to a method, and the method is defined here. Now, when this program executes, what we're going to see is this, and I'm not showing it counting up, I've just taken a screenshot. Now, when we create an instance of the digital clock, this will execute, and within this we can see I've added this additional line which we'll call this method. If we look to the first line of this method, what we can see is that we're creating a menu, and this menu is going to be known by this name here, self.my_menu_bar. Now, this ultimately will lead to a menu bar appearing here. Now, of course, this menu bar will appear on this window because of this parameter I'm passing in. And this parameter, you can see, was set here to this, which was passed to here. And of course, this got its value from here when we created the instance of the digital clock. Now, the reason this is available within this method, even though it was this method which set this value, is because we're using the word self here. And the word self is very useful because it means that every time you see self anywhere in this definition of the digital clock, you know the individual methods will have access to it. Now, this line has access to this because if you look at the definition of this method, you can see here that it's passed self. So this knows that it belongs to the current instance that has been created on this line. So you can look to the code and see self appears in many places, and that's because we want the code within this definition of the digital clock to be available throughout the definition of the digital clock. And of course, I've covered self in a lot of detail in previous videos in the Python playlist. So if you're still unsure about self, I highly recommend that you go back and look at that video. Search for self on my YouTube channel or in the search box in the supporting website. and you will find information regards this important word when used within a Python program that uses object-oriented techniques. Now this line is a program statement that's part of the code necessary to add a drop-down menu to this word settings here that you can see on the screenshot of the runtime. If you look, you can see I'm using the method menu and I'm passing into it this, which was created on this line. And you can see this is its name here, which I've simply placed within here. This is another option I pass in, where tearoff is made equal to zero, which means that you cannot remove this menu here from the window and have it floating. Now this line invokes this method, and we can see the dot notation means that it's a method of this object, which was created on this line, as we can see by this name here being the same as this name. And of course, if we return to the method, we can see that I'm passing in these two, and this will make the drop down item have the text small font size. And this is saying that if the user were to click onto this label, don't do anything. It's saying that the command is none. Now, I'll be altering that when we move on to the next slide. If you look here, we're adding another menu item and we're giving that the label large font size. And again, you can see here that I'm saying the command is assigned none, meaning I haven't attached a command to this drop-down label yet. Now, if we consider this line, you can see that we're invoking the add underscore cascade method associated with the menu bar that was created here. And if we look at the parameters that were sent to the add underscore cascade method, you can see that the label was set to settings, and you can see that appears here. And we're passing in the drop down menu to the menu. Consequently, what would be attached to this would be these two labels that we'll see in a moment. After the execution of this line, the menu will not have appeared on the runtime. This is the line that ensures that the menu does appear, and you can see we're referring to the window, and I'm invoking this method associated with this object. And of course, what I'm doing, I'm saying let your menu be equal to self my menu bar that was created on this line. Of course, although the menu bar was created on this line, we have seen that these lines add the drop-down menu to the settings menu. Now, when this method has finished its execution, you will see the menu bar will have the word settings on, as shown here. And of course, if you were to click on settings, what you're going to see is this. You're going to see small font size and large font size, and that's because of this here. As it stands, the program will not carry out what I wanted it to achieve. And that is, if I was to click on small font size here, then the clock will get smaller because this label will become smaller and the window will resize to the size of the label. Now, the reason clicking on here will not work is if you look here, I've made the command equal none, which means I haven't tied any code to this label here. Now, I'm going to show that on the next slide. And just for completeness, of course, if I was to click onto this label, you can see here that nothing's going to happen because I've made command equal none. To ensure that this program functions correctly, what I'm going to have to do is to alter these here such that they will be equal to the name of a method that I'm yet to define. And those methods will be responsible for changing the size of the label so that the size of the clock will then ultimately change. And I'm going to have a look at that in the next slide. I'm going to home in on this method together with the two methods that I need to add to the class definition that will enable this program to function properly. So here you can see I've homed in on the code that I was referring to a moment ago, and you can see that I have added two methods. This method is called small underscore font, and this one is called large underscore font. If we look to this one first, you can see there's only one line in it, and what I'm doing, I'm referring to the label and I'm referring to its font property, and I'm making it equal to this. And look at the size of the font, it's size 40. If I move on to this, you can see its name is large underscore font, and it's almost an identical line of code within it, the difference being that I'm now assigning to the font property of the label this, and you can see here that the size is 80. Now I have to arrange for the code to execute this method as appropriate when the user clicks on the item in the drop-down menu. And to achieve that, I'm going to refer you to this line where you can see here I've made the command equal to this. And look, and you can see that this is the name of this method. Turn your attention now to this line of code, and you can see here that I'm making the command equal to self.large underscore font. Now this is referring to this method here. So when the user clicks on this label in the drop-down menu, this is the code that will execute. And you can see this will then execute, which will alter the font size to 80. To emphasize this point, consider a screenshot of the computer program when it runs. Here you can see it. Now, if I was to click on to settings, what's going to happen? We're going to get this drop-down menu appear. Now, if I was then to click on to this label, because of this line, setting the command to this, we would find that this here would execute and the clock would get smaller. Let's now assume the clock is smaller, and if I was now to click on to this where it says large font size, if we refer to this line, you can see that the command is being made equal to this, which is referring to this here. And of course this will execute, make the font size 80, and of course the clock would now come back to the size that's the larger size because the font has been made bigger. So we can see that we can tie these two to code because of this here, setting the command appropriately. Now I recommend you have a go at implementing this program, but something you might want to think about is this. If you look at these names here, small font size and large font size, I call them that to hopefully make the program a little bit easier to understand because it is directly showing you what I'm doing in the code. I'm changing the font size. But a user of this graphical user interface might not appreciate these names. Perhaps this would be better named small clock and this large clock. Have a go at implementing the program as it's shown in this video, but then maybe muck around with it yourself and change these names here. Also consider further amending the program once you've got it working by adding to this drop-down menu here medium size clock or medium font size, whatever you would prefer to use. This is the computer program for the clock that you saw at the beginning of this video. I would normally have some line spaces in this, but I've removed them so you can see the program more easily on one slide. I've recommended that you get this program working, and then I suggested that you may possibly want to alter it to have better names than these here, small font size and large font size. Maybe small clock, large clock. Of course, what I also then went on to say is why not have another label in the drop-down menu that allowed you to have a medium size digital clock. And that would involve you in this region adding another menu item to the drop-down menu and also having another method in addition to these two that you already had, where that method would be responsible for setting the font size to a different number than these two, possibly 60 for example. Check out the supporting website for these videos. In addition, why not follow me on Twitter as I issue a tweet every time I upload a new video.